Oh, we're good then. All right, so I come by.
Here I am, Rabbi Hirsch, all alone in a foreign country. It's cold, it's dark. I need help. Help! Will you please give me a help?
I am Michael. I am a halter boy at Sacred Heart. I'm a Catholic, and I'm late for the 8 o'clock mass.
Not even 1 minute?
Okay, make it fast. What can I do for you?
Just a little light.
You mean turn the light on? Why don't you do it yourself?
It's not permitted, you see. Today is Shabbos.
Okay, I'll turn it on. But
because a little light is good for fellow men.
Okay. morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Helen Payne. I am going to present to you the events in a book. There was a terrible snowstorm. In 1946, Michael Devlin, he lived in Brooklyn with his mother. Michael was on his way to the Sacred Heart Church when he met Rabbi Hirsch. Master G was beat up by the town bullies. Michael thought Jews killed Jesus, but he found out Romans killed Jesus. Rabbi Hirsch took Michael on a trip down the memory lane.
Well, my name is Merle Porter, and I'm going to conclude. My name is Merle Porter, and I'm going to conclude the event of the book. As you can see over there, you can read and follow. Michael wanted to learn Yiddish, so he made it friends. So he made friends with the rabbi. Michael was beaten and spent 9 days in the hospital. The rabbi went to visit Michael. Michael's mother was concerned about their safety. The rabbi was beaten severely.
My name is Admire, and I'll do the ending of the book. Michael used spiritual rites instructed to him by the rabbi to form the golem. The golem came to life and went with Michael to the pool room where the Falcons were having a party for Frankie after his release from jail. At first, the golem made them invisible. Then later, they were visible. Michael pointed to all the Falcons in the room. They were punished severely and sent out in the snow with no clothes on. Frankie was to go to the police station and confess to all the crimes he committed. He left the pool room with a leash around his waist. And now I will call on Sharon and Bridget, who will do the math.
Has an ancient university. The martyr Jan Hus was the rector and professor of the university. It was one time the home of such composers as Mozart, Weber, and Antonia the Farm. And the writings as Kafta and Kapit. In modern times, it has become the leading industrial center of the country. Physical description. Prague is situated on the banks of the Jultava River. The modern city covers hilly areas expanding into part of the Jultava River. The river and hills created problems for the city's growth, but it also enhanced its beauty. The historic core lies on both sides of the river. The center of the modern Prague is Wensleben. It has a population of 1.2 million. The majority of the people are Czechs, with a small number of Slovaks, Hungarians, and Germans. Greeks are mainly Roman Catholics, with a Protestant minority of different sects. There is a small Jewish community. Czechoslovakia is one of the most industrial countries in Eastern Europe. Some of the products include transport equipment, electrical goods, and various machinery. The International Airport at Luz is the headquarters of the Czechoslovakian Airlines. The earliest record settlement at Prague dates from the 9th century. Unfortunately, the century was a turbulent one for the citizens. But by 1945, Prague became the capital again. Since the breaking up of communism, Prague has regained its wealth and splendor. It is now one of the most visited countries in Europe. I will now introduce to you Albert, Georgia, and Jacqueline from Connected with Ems Field.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Albert Wood. We are the Robert Jackson team. Jackie Robinson team. I would like to read from my experience of studying about Jackie Robinson. Jackie Robinson was born in Cairo, Georgia, in the year of 1919. As a young boy, his family moved to California City, the city of Pasadena, while attending UCLA, he did track running. He also played football too. But we know him most of all for his famous title in the whole wide world as a baseball player. But unfortunately, at the time of him playing baseball, it was racial segregation time and the law of the land. Blacks could not eat or stay in the same hotel as white Americans. So you can imagine what it was like during that time in America. I'm in America. So, just a minute. Getting nervous, that's all. The rabbi and Micah could identify with Jackie Robinson's struggle. And the Jews, and also the Irish Catholic. So the rabbi understands of Jackie Robinson's struggles, and he became very fond of Jackie Robinson. The rabbi also offered up a prayer for Jackie Robinson and his safekeeping as he went through his worldwide baseball game.
Good morning, my name is Jacqueline Guzman. Okay, the topic is Jackie Robinson. Branch Rickey did not sign Jackie to play baseball out of love for black people. There was a lot of pressure from the black press and organization like the NAACP. Jackie's signing caused a backlash among fans as well as his teammates. Baseball fans and players reacted to Robinson with everything from unbridled enthusiasm to open hostility. Jackie Robinson signed to play baseball for the Kansas City Monarch. After he got out of the Army, the Dodgers played baseball in the Flatbush section of Brooklyn in a place called Ebbets Field. When the Dodgers left Brooklyn in 1957, it broke the people of Brooklyn's heart. The people of Brooklyn never forgave the O'Malley family for leaving Brooklyn.
Hello, my name is Georgia Gardner, and I'm going to read on Jackie Robinson. Jackie Rosa Robinson was born in 1990 and died in 1972. He played baseball with the Brooklyn Dodgers from 1947 to 1956. He had a lifetime batting average of .311 and was introduced into the Hall of Fame in 1962. Jackie was born in Georgia. His family moved to California when was a young boy. He attended UCLA for 2 years. His first priority after leaving school was finding work. Work was scarce, and the defense plan that were going into production were not hiring many blacks. The few who did manage to get a job were not paid the same as white Americans. By the way, he played baseball and football at UCLA. He was charmed by a recollection of a conversation he had with a scout who told him if he was white, he could make $50,000 a year. Cobb Anderson says, "Get the nigger off the field." Hate mail came in great volume at first. There were threats on Jackie Robinson's life and his family also. The Georgia's front office made an effort to keep the hate mail away from him. There were no major incidents. Soon, the hate mail slowed down as the mails from sincere fans, black and white, was received. Black and white people alike fell in love because of pride and how he played baseball. Jackie Robinson was the first black man to play. His success experience opened the door for other black players. I now produce it to the religion group.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Hamill. My name is Marlene Dixon. I attend classes here at 1199 Training Fund. My topic is religion and how it played out throughout the book between Michael and the rabbi. The two religions that come together in this book are Judaism and Catholicism. The Jewish religion is an ancient religion long before Christ, who himself was a Jew. As the basis of their beliefs, they read the first five books of the New Old Testament, which is called the Torah. They worship on Saturdays, which is called the Sabbath. For the Jews, any physical work is forbidden on the Sabbath. This is how Rabbi Hirsch met Michael Devlin. It was his Sabbath, and he needed someone to turn on the lights in the synagogue. Rabbi Hirsch was very devoted to his religion. He was in darkness, and still, he did not turn the lights on because that would have been work to him. Michael, Catholic, and very active in the church. He was an altar boy. Michael worships on Sundays because that is the Catholic day of observance. The Catholic religion came about around 300 AC after Christ with Emperor Constantine. Constantine created the Catholic Church and papacy because as a politician, he realized that religion was a big political force. So the Catholic Apostolic Roman Church was created with a pope as the head. Constantine changed worshiping on the Sabbath to Sunday worship. The differences between the two religions, for example, the Jews' observance of the Sabbath, and they are the differences between the two religions, for example, is the Jews' observance of the Sabbath, and that they are still waiting for the Messiah to come, while the Catholic worships on Sundays and are waiting for the second coming of Christ. Rabbi Hirsch and Michael treated each other with a lot of respect for each other's religion. They did not try to change each other from their religion or tradition. It was a special relationship between the two characters. They cared about learning from each other instead of trying to change one another. Rabbi Hirsch wanted to learn English from Michael. In return, he would teach Michael Yiddish. To Michael, learning Yiddish would give him such an advantage. He would know a language none of his friends understand. That was something he would have for himself. It paid off for him when he and his mother went shopping for that suit. And when he spoke Yiddish to the storekeeper, they got an additional percentage off. He surprised the storekeeper and his mom. This book teaches us that not everyone are bigots. People of different religion and culture can come together. I will now introduce World War II and the Nazis by Juan Crespo and Phyllis Harris.
Good morning. My name is Juan Crespo, and I'm going to introduce to you the events that took place that brought Rabbi Hirsch to Brooklyn. The timeline. 1937, Rabbi Hirsch meets Leah Uransky. Okay? He was in a meeting in Prague. She was very young and smart and brave and very concerned about the future of the Jewish people. She was alert about Hitler's doings and about Hitler's persecution of the Jews. After a few meetings, they fell in love. Okay, September 7th, 1939, Rabbi Hirsch and Leah Uransky get married. It was a small ceremony, no dancing, no laughing, because Leah said, with such much suffering by the Jews, there shouldn't be. Happening right now, after the Jews are all together in Israel, we could have a great party and we could dance for a whole week. The day after the wedding, Leah had to go for 5 days to Poland. After an argument with the rabbi, because he was complaining that she was leaving so soon after the wedding, but she left anyway. Soon after, she got in trouble with the Nazis. okay? September 1st, 1939, Germany invades Poland. England and France demanded that Germany withdraw its troops. When Germany refuses, England and France declare war on Germany. Within weeks, Great Britain is joined in the war by Canada, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and India. Ireland was the only member of the British Commonwealth that stayed out of the war. During that time, at the beginning of the war, Rabbi Hirsch made an effort to find Leah. After he made it back to Prague, it was made clear to him by members of the underground that his life was in danger. This is over here. Next. A rabbi flees to save his life. He went through Yugoslavia, Romania, and Greece, and there he was able to catch a ship going to the Dominican Republic. The Dominican Republic, he spent several years there, and finally he was able to come to Brooklyn. He arrived at Ellis Island. There he met someone that had been on the underground, Leah, and he was able to get some information from him. And he told the rabbi that Leah had been arrested and that she had put up a fight. And before she was arrested, she had shot three of the Nazis. But they didn't kill her. They put her in a concentration camp because they figured that killing her would be too merciful for her. That's how the rabbi found out what had happened to his love, Leah. Okay. Then he went from there to Brooklyn, where he, in a very cold Sunday morning, the last week of that year, he met a young lad named Michael Devlin, and both of their lives were changed forever. Now, Phyllis Harris.
Thank you. Hi. My name is Phyllis Harris, and I represent in peace and the Falcon Immigration and quote-unquote. Rabbi Hershey, by immigration force or choice, was it emancipation for Rabbi Hershey? Rabbi Hershey was forced to flee this country because of fear for his life and looking for a safe haven with a synagogue. The Falcons were noted for their ruthless behavior with ringleader Frankie McCarthy, Alibi, Tippy, Skip, Ferret, and the Russian. They were just a set of troublemakers trying to get recognized on the street for their tough, bully lifestyle behavior. They were manipulators, ignorant, afraid, full of disappointment, and you'd want to pity them, who beat upon the ones that are vulnerable to them and powerless and who want to fight back. There were also vandals who sprayed hate words on buildings and dwellings. They were the tough guy that ruled the street on Ellison Avenue and came out in pack-like wolves, ready to destroy and take justice in their own hands and go back in hiding. Cowards they were. Unlike the Holocaust situation, which we have learned of the utter despair and hopelessness weighed more heavily in human life, the constant hunger, the beating, and the imminent death occurring every minute. Quote and quote from the rabbi when you reach America. On a Tuesday you work, my father said Jews don't play soccer. I love America. Irish and Jews and Italian and Spanish and Polish. Listen, words from every place. The rabbi's passion for life, love, and interest for knowledge based on a strong belief persuade his struggle. William's Conner is a survivor from the Holocaust, quote from his. He thinks that his encounter with young Germans disturbed them more than him. When they get an interval, he spent the war, he said, you can feel the static electricity in the air. My conclusion to all of this and the book, life, you can lose everything, but once you have life, there is hope. And perseverance and struggle is it. I will now introduce the Rabbi Diane. Good morning, ladies and gents. My name is Diana Ramsa. I'm representing Group 2. Our main goal is to give the author and others a view of what we think and see about Rabbi Hirsch as a person. Rabbi Hirsch came to New York due to the Nazi war and settled on Ellison Street. He was only in the U.S. 9 months before he met Michael Devlin, an Irish-American Catholic boy, and they became good friends. In our minds, we as a group think that Rabbi Hirsch is a very educated, devoted, kind, lonely, humorous, sincere, and quiet person. Here are a few examples to support our opinion. Rabbi Hirsch was devoted to his religion because he wouldn't do things that he shouldn't do. For example, turning on the lights or any kind of work on the Shabbos. He was kind because he was willing to share his knowledge with Michael. He took Michael to Ebbets Field to watch the ball game, which consists of an African-American player by the name of Jackie Robinson, who was disliked by the whites because of his color. But Michael and Rabbi Hirsch grew very fond of him as a person and not by the color of his skin. He taught Michael Yiddish, and he never forgot the things that Michael did for him and went to visit him for the first time at his home when he was beaten up by the Falcons. He was educated because he spent most of his time reading a lot of books. From there is where he gained most of his knowledge. To him, his books were like treasure. Lonely, he had no family or friends. He lost his wife and country to the Nazi war. He lived and experienced a terrible life in Prague from whence he came. Humorous, he would laugh about things Michael said and things he heard on the radio that seemed funny to him. For example, the different words. Sincere, he thought a lot about Michael. Quiet, he never really mixed with people because of what had happened during the war and what people thought about the Jews. His appearance was somewhat of an elderly and unclean person because of the way he carried himself and dresses. His beard was dark with touches of rusty red and gray. His small nose made his beard seem larger, more solid, as if it were carved from wood instead of made from hair. His fingernails were dirty, which made Michael wonder how old he was and what was going on in his life. His teeth was uneven and yellow as he smiled. His clothing was always black and his coat was ragged. He acted like he knew Michael for a very long time. They both seemed to have the same interests. For example, willing to learn and teach each other their language, but not to interfere with each other's religion. He doubted God because of all the bad things that were going on in the world and around him. Last but not least, the rabbi was a very determined and courageous person, despite all that he has been through. On conclusion, after reading the book, I personally think Rabbi Hirsch is not prejudiced, and I like him, not because of his color and religion, but as a person. I will now introduce to you Carol Evans, who will present the model, and thank you.
Imagination took him to places he read about. And his favorite comic book called The Captain's Mother. Michael was a good friend of the rabbi. And also he helped his mother. Michael was a student of the rabbi. Michael Delvin was a good student, as I said. He was also a good friend of the bad guys. A good friend of the bad guys because he didn't inform the police what they did. In my view, in my point of view, I think Michael was a good impression for young people and old people. To conclude, I am going to introduce Mr. Pete in the front.
I'm so impressed by this model. I want to live there. Well, thank you all. This is amazing. It's amazing for a writer to, you know, you sit and you write a book and you try to make it as best a piece that you can do, but you have no idea where it goes. It's like having a child who goes out into the world and you don't know where it's going to go. And different people will read it different ways from the way you wrote it. Your intentions shift. as the audience reacts to it, as the readers react to it, and I've never seen anything quite like this. This is just amazing, and I thank you very much. The map particularly impressed me because there is one missing stream, and it goes from Ireland, because it was the convergence of those two streams that make the relationship between the rabbi and the boy possible. And one of the things I wanted to do in the rabbi and the boy was to make clear, without being too abstract about it, that Christianity is the son of, or child of, Judaism. That Judaism is the font from which Christianity came. And so the relationship of the boy to the father is in many ways the same as the relationship of Christianity to Judaism. But as a Catholic, I explained earlier that I had a Catholic vision in my head too, which is that the rabbi is the father, the boy is the son, and Jackie Robinson is the Holy Ghost. So, the Holy Ghost, as we all know, is hard to see. You know, in those days, one of the things about the book that was most difficult to do is to explain to people that there was actually a time in the world when there was no television, so that the imagination was fed by the written word and the spoken word, but not as much by visual images as by stories. The stories we heard from our parents, the stories we heard on street corners, the things we learned at school, and what we heard on the radio. And so that era was a time when the theme of the book is first you imagine, then you live. And so they both imagine Jackie Robinson before they ever get to see him. They imagine him as a figure before they get to see him actually do what he does, because there is no television. There are still photographs in the newspapers, and you can see some of them on this wonderful wall up here. But the impact could not be made by a still photograph. The great accomplishment of Robinson, and the reason for people like me, because I was exactly the same age as Michael in that year, why he meant so much to us was that it wasn't that he integrated baseball, he integrated the stands. And when he integrated the stands, he began the process of integrating America. You had to integrate the stands. He knew that for him to hit 350 meant that he was doing it on talent alone, but that there had to be a country in which people who hit 220 could exist. That you had to do this not for superstars, you had to do it for everybody. And so, the other part of what he did for a lot of us, black and white in that era, and I talk, as you know, in the Ebbets Field chapter about how there were black people who came to that park that summer, who had waited all their lives to get into a place and see a black man on the field play. It seems like a small thing now. So much has happened in between. But it was no small thing then. It was an amazing accomplishment. And for us, because we were white, the example of it was not about so much about race, but about tenacity and will, by saying, no matter what you do, I will triumph, is what Robinson says. The rabbi, in his way, at the end of the book, and we'll talk about that, I'm sure, later, is saying, you can put us in your concentration camps, you can keep us out of your country clubs, you can make us, you can sneer at us, you can insult us, we will triumph. We will dance, not simply endure, but dance. that we will celebrate our existence no matter what. And that's where Robinson and the rabbi are the same people in certain ways. So Robinson, it was no accident, by the way, that by the end of the summer of 1947, half the white kids in Brooklyn were walking pigeon-toed. Because that's the way Robinson walked. Robinson walked this way. And we all tried to walk that way. The book itself, which we can get into if you want to obviously ask questions about, is about that. It's about belief on certain levels. The rabbi, because of the horrors of the Holocaust, has lost his ability to believe in some ways. The boy hasn't. The boy can believe in Captain Marvel. He can believe in Irish mythology. He can believe, he can hear Dvorak in his head staring at the clouds on a summer afternoon on a rooftop in Brooklyn before he ever hears it in reality. His version of the New World Symphony is an act of the imagination, but it is just as vivid and just as meaningful to him as if he had sat in Carnegie Hall and heard it. He creates it himself. And so part of what the book, I hope, does is let the readers believe in their own imaginations and the value of it, the power of it. When we were kids, we were talking earlier, we used to get scolded for daydreaming, you know. You'd get scolded by a school teacher for looking out the window. You'd get scolded sometimes by your parents for doing it. But it was the most important thing we were doing as children. We were imagining a world. And when I say you imagine and then you live, I mean you imagine everything. You imagine the power of your life. You imagine the people you, the way you will live 30 years from now, not Saturday night, but the whole life. Kids in this country are too often told to live their youth and nothing else. And we have to live our whole lives. And one of the things that I think the tradition of Judaism, the tradition of Christianity, teaches people is continuity. That even though we do stupid things, we're all capable of human folly, that there's a continuity that allows us to go on and to imagine a better time. Imagine the light at the end of that other tunnel. The other important character in the book is the mother. And it was based clearly on my own mother, who came as an immigrant in 1929, arriving with perfect Irish timing on the day the stock market crashed. Worked as a domestic, worked, I am proud to say, as a hospital worker for 3 years. And then worked as a cashier in a movie house, the old RKO Prospect on 9th Street in Brooklyn. And we could therefore get in for free. It was like one of the great things. She would not, however, allow us in for free unless we got library cards. The library was up on the corner. There were 7 kids. I was the oldest of 7 children. And they had to get the library. We had to get the library card. I was more like Michael Dell. I didn't need, you know, the bribery of watching some Dolby movie with Mario Lanza or Doris Day or something. But my brother certainly needed it. And so she understood as an immigrant, and coming from a place where life was not easy for the kind of people that she came from. My father came from also from Belfast. He had an 8th grade education. My mother, astonishingly, had a high school education. It was very hard for women in those days to get that. But they understood that the way out of it, the reason they were here, was because the library was free. Because all the accumulated wisdom of the world was in that library. That it was free. It was a temple of human memory. Place where you could go in and take the things that the wisest and sometimes the most foolish people in world history had accumulated on the shelves. Having that sense was at the center of the whole way we grew up in Brooklyn in those days. It didn't matter that we were poor. Who the hell cared? That wasn't it. She would take us on rides on the subway and we take it, the subway was a nickel then, so it was a lot easier. And just take us to different areas. Take us to Chinatown. Take us to Orchard Street. Take us to go to the docks on the North River, on the Hudson River, to just see this world, this amazing place. And she would say, listen to that, that's Chinese. She didn't understand a word of it, nor did we. But the idea that it existed, that there were people not like ourselves, was at the heart of her curiosity, and it was at the heart of the curiosity of many, many other people who came from that generation as children of immigrants. It was, she used to say to us when we would go to Manhattan from Brooklyn, and Manhattan was like a different country in a way. You know, we'd say, you know, we're going over New York, is the way they said it in Brooklyn. In Queens, they said, we're going to the city. But it was still a different place. But occasionally we would see some poor soul sitting in a hallway panhandling something, and my brothers and I, being kids, being wise guys, apprentice wise guys, would snicker or make remarks, and she'd say, never look down on anybody unless you're offering them a hand to get up. And I think it's the way we tried to live our lives. You know, you could not necessarily give every person a hand to get up, but you could, if you were a writer, you used your typewriter. You used your newspaper to give people a hand to get up. And you can, that's all you can do in a way. You can't give a person a life, but you can give them a hand to get up. And all of that feeling is in, I hope, the mother in this book, because she goes back and forth trying to avoid self-pity. You know, she was not going to use cheap tears to get someone to feel sorry for her. She was too proud for that. But to keep human emotion alive in spite of terrible things, in spite of danger, and to make sure that you kept your children going ahead with that idea of the future, that idea of possibility, the idea of the world. So I hope all of that is in there. And I'd love to hear from you your questions and puzzlements.
What part, if any, you played in the book?
What part, if any, do I play in the book? Well, I was a Shabbos goy to start with when I was in 1947. And I thought for years that this was a very unique thing. You know, I was a Shabbos goy too. And then I learned about 6 years ago that Colin Powell had been a Shabbos goy. I said, well, good. Then I heard Mario Cuomo had been a Shabbos goy. And then my friend Nick Pileggi, who wrote Goodfellas, the screenplay for Goodfellas, which was directed by Marty Scorsese, he said, you write a book about a Shabbos goy? I said, no. He said, you know, Marty Scorsese's father was a Shabbos goy. And then, worst of all, about 6 months ago, New York Magazine, I read an article that said that 40 years ago, in Memphis, Tennessee, Elvis Presley had been a Shabbos goy. So whatever uniqueness I thought I had, whatever, you know, vanity I had about having done that, evaporated fairly quickly. But it was an important thing because I think that the end of parochialism, the end of the narrowness of our lives, which can have great strength, you know, and is amazingly valuable, family, immediate neighborhood, close friends. The way to fully live a life is to be able to also know the other lives. And that begins by crossing the street. You gotta cross the street. If someone says, please go help in the middle of a snowstorm, you better go. Because over there lies, as you all know from the book, the other kids think there's a buried treasure in the synagogue. There is. It's not what they thought it was. It was wisdom. It was the treasure. It was in here, not in some tin box with a lot of glittering gold. But crossing that street is the beginning of the process of understanding how we're all in this thing.
Thank you.
Did you have a part two?
Yes.
You have that part two look on your face.
At what age you decided to start writing?
Around the same time. What age did I decide to start writing? And I started around. I started around the same time writing comic books because I loved comic books. So I would get these illustration books that you could use in school, divide them up into panels, and have amazing adventures about kids from Brooklyn who won the war against the Nazis and stuff. You know, they were very crude, but, you know, as a kid would be, but they were a way of telling a story, you know, that, and I love comic books. And whenever I see kids reading comic books, I say, read more. Because it's about a narrative. It's about this picture and scene leads to this, leads to that, leads to this. So that was the way I began. But I, for years, I wanted to be an artist, and then I failed into writing. So that happened much later when I went off to school after the Navy. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, your book inspired a lot of people, and I got into one fight with my co-worker because of your picture on that book. I don't know if too many people have taken a good look at this picture. I mean, this, I was in the hospital for a few weeks, and this kept me going. And I met this lady on the subway, and she said to me, can I read this book? You know, like when you read to have a newspaper and you have not read it and somebody asks you to read it and you get real upset. I said, well, I just got it. Where did you get it? I said, Barnes & Noble. I've never heard about you before. But a friend of mine said, oh, can we trade? I have a book. I said, no, we can't. So she said, okay. All you were concerned about was the picture at the back of the desk. Well, excuse me, you ain't gonna get a chance to meet this guy before I do. So, this lady says, can I get your number so when you finish reading this book, I can get your
number? What line in the subway was this? I want to go there and sell books.
So at the hospital, in all the pain that I was in, every time I opened the book, I didn't get to read too much because I was always asleep with all this medication and everything, but it really kept me going. And I want to ask you, when you wrote that book, was that on a very cold winter day?
I actually did write a lot of it through a winter, but it was not, and nothing like the winter of 1947. That was the Babe Ruth of winters around here. It was in fact a huge storm, as described in the book. But because when you're writing fiction, you're rearranging reality to make it more coherent in a way, or make it truer than the facts. I actually took the snowstorm from the end of the real year of 1947 and put it at the beginning. And I made some other alterations. For example, the pool room. I go to some event last year at the New York Historical Society, and the head of security is a guy I knew when I was 11. Eddie Norris was his name. He had gone on to spend 30 years in the police department and was now the head of security at the New York Historical Society. And he came over to me and said, hey, Pete, I read your book. I said, yeah, what did you think, Eddie? He said, you got the pool room on the wrong side of the street. I said, Eddie, I needed it. I didn't want the boy to come out and turn left to the pool room. I wanted him to see the pool room. So you make alterations when you're writing fiction. Ellison Avenue, for example, is really 7th Avenue in Brooklyn. I don't know how familiar you are with that area. It's where John Jay High School is now, at one end of it, and it goes from Greenwood Cemetery all the way to Flatbush. I changed the names because these days everybody has a lawyer. So you put in the real street, they say, hey, I lived in that street, you know. We didn't do anything like that. And the next thing you know, you're in court. So I wanted a street that evoked the memory of Ellis Island. So I used Ellison Avenue as 7th Avenue. But you do, when you're writing a novel, you're trying to make it more real, calling the past. You're not literally writing it the way you would if you were writing autobiography or memoir, where you have to be absolutely true to the facts. So there are alterations in there that you wouldn't be able to find. If you took the book and looked around Brooklyn and said, where the hell's Ellison Avenue? You wouldn't find it, except right over on that table. Now it lives. Yes?
Seeing that Michael Devlin is a father that killed his son in the Second World War. His mother was a single parent. What's the difference now as today?
Michael's father was killed in the war, and therefore the mother was a single parent. And what's the difference then as compared to now? There's no difference, obviously. The task of raising a child as a single parent is a difficult one, but it's doable. You know, it requires whether the single parent's a man or more likely a woman. It requires amazing strength of character, and particularly now because there are differences now, not in the task, but in the dangers. For example, in that period, there were very few drugs in New York. You know, you didn't have to worry about kids going out in the street getting, you know, corrupted by drugs. There were very few of it. The drugs didn't arrive in most neighborhoods until the early 1950s. So clubs were not there. The second is there was no television. Because kids can sit and knock themselves out on television. You've got a single parent, they either working or they're fully occupied with trying to raise one. One is easy. Trying to raise five would have been infinitely worse. The television offers a vision of the world that's easy. You think life's going to be easy when you look at television. Whereas television, you don't have to do that work. So I think for a single parent now, it's very hard to get a kid to read because the distraction of television is there all the time. It's very hard for a kid to realize that work is required in a life. Because television, you talk about a mood-altering drug. You can go from football to a soap opera to a war documentary just with a click of a button. It's a kind of drug in that sense. You can't read that way. You got to reorganize your mind to read a book about World War II and a book about sports and something like that. So I think it's difficult for parents now. But that it's doable. I mean, the whole point is that it's doable. It requires amazing will and concentration. But it's doable.
Questions about Sonny. Yeah.
Sonny Montemarano?
Yes. What a mouth.
Questions about Sonny Montemarano. What a mouth.
Yeah, what a mouth. Where did he find this mouth? Because Mike is going to be a very moral
person. Well, Sonny, Michael's cursing is very controlled. To Sonny, it's part of the rhythm of the way he talks. To Sonny as obviously comes from, you know, another part of the same neighborhood, but where the cursing is much more common. You know, it's like part of the texture of the way when people talk. So that Sonny is not even literally meaning the words he's using. They're just there. They're part of the rhythm of things. Whereas Michael, who is, as you can see, is from the beginning, is interested in words and the magic that attaches to them, whether it's Shazam or Yiddish, is more careful about language. He's thinking about the words. And he knows one thing. Words have magic. That there is magic in words. A world with words, just through the magic and power of words. Whereas Sonny, he uses them in a totally different way. He's unself-conscious about them. He's not trying to do a riff. He's not trying to say, I'll be real funny now and put as many curses in this sentence as I can. There are people like that we all know. But he's not thinking in the same way that Michael would be. And I think kids are different. And the three kids can be very, very close friends and each have a different style and a different attitude towards the world and go different ways when they grow up. Yes, ma'am.
How did you feel about the names? How did you come about the characters, the names that you use?
How did I come up with the names? My mother's maiden name is Devil. So that was easy. I knew she wouldn't sue me. Rabbi Hirsch's first name, Judah, is the same name as Rabbi Lowe from Prague. The statue I saw when I went to Prague in 1989, I saw the statue in the cemetery in the ghetto in Prague. And it was, his name is Judah Lowe. So I used his first name, Rabbi Hirsch's first name. And I used to know a prize fighter named Hirsch. So tough. He couldn't really fight, but he was tough. His name was Georgie Hirsch, who boxed in a gym on 14th Street at Irving Place right down here. So you cobble them together in different ways. And some of them you want a rhythm, you know. When you're writing a novel, you don't want to have three characters whose names all start with the same letter. Because the reader gets confused. Is this George, Gary, or Grant? You know, you don't want to have three G's among the principal characters. You try to give enough variety in the names so that people, when they're reading, keep distinguishing. You know, particularly when they're reading fast. I'm trying to think of some of the other names. Sonny Montemorano was actually a real guy named Donnie Montemorano, who ended up in the mafia, you know, and worked for Junior Persico and some of these other guys in South Brooklyn. Those are the major names. There were so many McCarthys in Brooklyn in those days that I knew I was safe with McCarthy. Yes, ma'am. Well, I use the curse words in order to distinguish between characters. You know, as we talked about here, Montemorano, that kid, curses a lot. Michael doesn't. He's very careful with it. The closest he gets is goddamn, you know, in terms of real cursing. Mother never curses. The rabbi does, but he does it in a kind of scrambled way, you know. Part of it was to really establish the level at which people could really talk about. Vulgarity and cursing got much worse. This was a time when people didn't quite use all the words they use now, almost casually. You know, you get a subway tuck in your purse. But it was a way of distinguishing characters. When you're trying to get clear in your head when you're writing, what distinguishes these characters? If they all talk the same way, then they're probably talking like a writer. But if you can give them different rhythms, different ways of speaking, to keep it clear without calling a lot of attention to it, it does help distinguish. So that feeling offended about the language of Sonny, is the right way to feel. You know, he's a different kid from some of the other kids. And you wouldn't notice that if they all talk the same. You wouldn't be able to quite distinguish them in the way I hoped that I was able to do this. Unless they spoke it. Yes, ma'am. Well, that's a good question. Why was I so interested in Yiddish rather than in my mother's birth language, which was Gaelic? To begin with, the people from Northern Ireland, particularly, and most of Ireland, had lost their language. They didn't have the language. You know, as But one of the things that colonialism did classically was try to steal people's language from them, you know, everywhere, whoever the colonial power. The second was that in 1946 and 47, before the great Latino migration to New York, the second language in New York was Yiddish. You know, it wasn't Spanish. If this story were happening now, it would be probably, if you were going to try to learn another language, you would learn Spanish, which he could literally use. He could use Yiddish in those days, as the boy discovers when he gets the origins. But it was like a language that didn't have, it had newspapers, the foreword is a newspaper that lasted, it's still now weekly in English. At its peak, it sold 250,000 of them. So it was literally the second language. So learning that language would be like a kid today saying, an Irish kid saying, I'm not learning Spanish, else I'm not really a New Yorker. You know, to try to get that other language. Yes, ma'am.
Upon writing this book, how long did
it take to write the book? About the whole process was like 2 years, because this one, unlike sitting down and just writing, I had to do research into Prague. I had been to Prague, but I had to go read about the Golem. I had to read about the Kabbalah, because I knew if I got that wrong, the whole book would collapse. You know, there would be people saying, "What does this guy know?" You know, and that's why I put a bibliography at the end of the book. Listing some of the books that I consulted so that people who are interested could go and find out more. Because, you know, this is a book, a story told from the point of view of an 11-year-old. I couldn't make him more sophisticated than he was. You know, so you had to have him discovering and encyclopedia these things on his own. But because there was a lot of research, it took longer than it might ordinarily have taken. And particularly if you're writing a novel that requires research, you don't want it to sound like research. You want it to feel like it's been absorbed by the characters. So one of the ways to do that is to do the reading, then back up and write out of the memory of your reading rather than consulting the research. And then you can always go back and check the facts if you need a year or a date or something like that. But it's remembering what you do. Did I write it on my life experience? Everything, you know, for a writer, everything is experience. Reading is experience, you know. But as I said earlier, I was, in fact, an altar boy, and I lived in a parish like that. My father was not dead. My father was alive. But the kinds of people that are in the book, some specifically and some more general, are people that I knew growing up. And the situations were real. I mean, what was amazing after the war, having gone through the war, having seen the movies from Buchenwald and concentration camps, that there was still anti-Semitism around was astonishing. You know, it was as if nobody had learned anything. We just ended up with 40 million dead, you know, in the whole worldwide part of the war. And there were still people like Frankie McCarthy wandering around, thinking the Jews started it, you know. So in that sense, it does come out of life experience. And certainly, I was at the game with Jackie Robinson, by the way. And I think it's worth knowing that in that scene, I was at that game where he got hit by a pitch, stole second, and scored on a single. He was talking to Hank Greenberg, who was the biggest Jewish star in baseball history at that time. He was the first baseman for the Pittsburgh Pirates that year. It was his last year of baseball. And I could see Robinson from where I was, Robinson talking to Greenberg. But I couldn't obviously hear it. So when I was writing the book and remembering that scene, I called up a friend of mine who had written a book about Greenberg. I said, "Do you know anything about Greenberg and Robinson?" And he said, "Yeah." He says, "There was this game in Ebbets Field." And he started describing the same game. I said, "What did they talk about?" And apparently Robinson came down to first base having been hit with the first pitch. And he said to Greenberg, I'm going to pull him out of the baseline. I'm going to run him over. I'm going to trample him. He's just telling Greenberg all the things he's going to do to this pitcher. And Greenberg said, don't worry about it, kid. They pulled the same crap on me as a Jew 20 years early. So that was also a little connection that obviously was not my life experience, but I was at the game. In research, you find out the other bits and pieces that really have. I didn't use that because there's no way the boy could know it, but that was what was behind that story. Yes, sir.
Yes. I have a question for you. Is that I want to ask you if a pit, Hamill is your real name, Michael Devlin? Because you said earlier that you love to read comic books.
Right.
And in the book you're talking about with Michael, he loves also comic books.
Right.
I want to know exactly which one is Michael and which one is you.
Well, to be truthful, my real name is William Peter Hamill. Because my father's name was William. So even Pete Hamill is another version of my actual name. But the Michael Devlin is clearly autobiographical, but not in the strict sense. You know, not, in other words, not in a way that if you had to write an absolute strict accounting of it. But certainly the emotions of the boy struggling with trying to make sense of the world that he's in at 11, which is a very difficult age for anybody, trying to make sense of it. I think all of that is very much me. But what comes from that, because fiction is an act of the imagination, fiction is saying, what if, or I wish. It says those things. I wish I had a golem, you know. Then you say, how would I make a golem? I wish I could play, you know, center field for the Dodgers. I wish I could go to Mars. It all fiction comes out of that desire and sense of the possible that you can imagine. And I think most of literature does. You know, most of literature comes out of that desire to be someone other than yourself, to be yourself plus, you know. And so it's a question that applies not just to me, but to thousands of writers over the years. In the end, the creations are a part of the writer. You know, they are. Don Quixote is part of Cervantes. Cervantes imagines him, but also Don Quixote is essential to Cervantes because he lives here. It's a part of him. But everything else becomes part of your life too. Reading, this book is now part of your experience. If you were going to write, you wouldn't write this book, but it's now part of your experience, just as everything else that happens, and sorting out what's important in that experience that making sense of a life is all about. And that ain't easy. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. As I read into the book, I find where it like take me places, a lot of places. Because I'm not like a type of person. I like to be in the street where all the action is, so I really do enjoy and I like your broad imagination and the timeline and the connection. I've
been
to Prague and I've
never been
there in the book.
Have you been there? Because what happens in the book, as you know, the boy imagines Prague before he gets there.
Yes.
And he imagines the golem before he sees one.
I see one.
So there's one kind of golem that he imagines and then another golem that comes. You know, the golem in a way is life, you know, it's like the power of the imagination is the golem. So, you know, you don't have to visit every single place in the planet, but you can know about them. And you can absorb them, know what they give them meaning. You give them the meaning by reading. If you read about them and they're boring, skip it. Don't worry about it. Find the thing. It's like listening to, you know, picking writers that you like is like listening to music.
Yeah.
You know, a certain writer has a kind of tone or an attitude. It's like a tune in your head.
Yeah, like the artist has.
And you hear them, and if you feel that, then read everything that they write. Read it, the whole thing. And don't feel bad if you don't get a certain writer. You say, I know this is a masterpiece, but I can't get past page 10. Don't feel bad. It means that it hasn't touched some place in your head, you know? Yes, sir.
The book seems so real. Why did you pick that fictional ending?
The fictional, no, everything in the book.
It seems so real.
I started with the ending. As an image in my head, and so the choice of the way the tale is told is to make, to add credibility to the end, you know, to be able to build all the way through Captain Marvel, Irish mythology, imagine things, wonder, magic words, to get one kind of an ending, but to have enough realistic stuff. Make it seem plausible. You know, it's a complicated process to do that. But I knew that the way I wanted the ending, I wanted it to sound like a symphony. I didn't want an ending that was like a very literal ending, as you say. You know, like a crawl at the end of a movie, you know, where it says, Richard Dreyfuss was indicted for so-and-so went so-and-so. I didn't want Rabbi Hirsch went to Israel and opened a restaurant. Michael became a sports writer. I didn't want to do that. I wanted it to have this feeling of opening out, not closing. That it would have a big opening like the end of some symphonies where they just roar to the ending and everything in the book comes. It's like the delta of a river, you know, you look at the Mississippi and there's a little line here and it comes down and it just widens out at the end. I want that sense of it being a delta. Now, whether I succeeded at it or not, I don't know.
You need the reader.
That was the intention.
You need the reader once
more. Yeah. I mean, I like movies where at the end of the movie, you don't turn to your girlfriend or your wife and say, okay, where do we eat? You know, I like movies where you walk out and say, what was that all about?
Yeah.
You know, what do you think they meant by, you know, I'd rather have that, where not everything is literal, that it has a kind of almost musical feeling.
A lot of people in this room are struggling writers. You really impart your words of wisdom on how to succeed as writers.
How to succeed as writers?
Yeah. How to succeed at writing.
Oh, at writing. Concrete nouns, active verbs. In other words, to me, the verbs are the most important thing in a piece of writing because they tell you what people do. You know, what do they do? I think of them as the teamsters, you know? They take the goods to the market. They are the active thing. They're the trucks that are going down the block with all those nouns in the back, trying to deliver them somewhere, you know? When I say concrete nouns, I mean pick words that are solid, that make pictures. One of the words I hate most in the world is the word it. You know, I just have a friend and never avoid it. He would write, it was hot. It seemed like a good day to get it on, you know? And it's like, what are these three different it's referring to here? You know, that were not concrete. So concrete nouns, active verbs, beginning of it. Then I think you've got to listen to your own, to the music in your head and trust that you're getting the rhythm down right. When I was a kid trying to learn, teach myself to write, and I think all writing, by the way, is self-taught. You teach yourself eventually. You can get great help from teachers, but you teach yourself. There were two things I would do. I would take a paragraph from some writer I liked. say it was Conrad, Joseph Conrad, and he's describing a storm at sea, I would take that paragraph and rewrite it as a snowstorm on land. And that means all, if you're changing rain to snow, all the nouns change. And also all the verbs change. But what you'll learn out of it is the structure of the paragraph. Almost every good paragraph is like, follows like a movie sequence. You'll have a wide establishing shot. It gives you the battlefield or whatever it is. Then you'll have what they call a two-shot, where you come in on a couple of characters, and then a close-up. So if you have that sort of three-step approach to writing a paragraph, where you open the paragraph with a sort of broad idea, and then you get tighter on it, then you have a detail. You know, if you someone's hit by a car, and you're looking out the window, you say, the street was empty, the car came running down. Then you're downstairs and you see someone bending over a child, and then you notice the detail of the child's shoes under the car. You know, this depends on how you do it, but think graphically about picture, making pictures when you're doing that kind of writing.
I'm describing a scene.
Yeah. And look for detail. Look for detail that reveals something, you know? I remember as a young reporter going, there was a murder somewhere, and a guy was, obviously, he was found in a hall, it was a payphone on the wall, and it was hanging, and one of the cops put his finger in the little slot and found the quarter, and knew then that he was obviously making a phone call when he was shot and went down. So they had a way of beginning to reconstruct what had actually happened. And if you're writing, you're doing that. You're telling someone a story. So one of the ways to think about it is as if you were writing a letter to someone you don't really know, but you respect. You know, you say, you don't have to say, Dear Charlie, to do it. But you don't get too convoluted in telling a direct communication. So communication is very important. And then the three-act structure is the heart of good writing, in my opinion. You know, that the three-act structure could be present, past, future. You know, you tell a story, something happening now. You go into the past to explain it. And then from that information, you can provoke the future.
Mr. Hamill, thank you for coming.
Okay, thank you.
We enjoyed your book. It taught us a lot about the difference between two cultures and religion, Christianity and Judaism. Also the difference between the language spoken by each. We enjoy reading your book immensely. On behalf of our students, parties, we now present to you this token of our appreciation.
Thank you very much.
Your time and effort.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Good. And thank you, darling. What's your name?
Iman.
Ah, that's sweet. You're so cute. I love that yellow outfit.
We'd like you to sit down.
People
would like to get their books signed.
Oh, sure.
And then there will be lunch for everyone in this room set up out here after getting books.
Thank you all.
In the
restaurant.
Where's your mother from in Belfast? The Short Strand.
Oh, from the Short Strand?
Yeah. Madrid Street, the Short Strand.
I shoot there.
I wonder if I liked your question. Have you ever met an author before?
Yes, and that's him. He mentioned Jamaica Kingston.
Oh, yeah. Does that make a difference when you read a book?
This one, it has a white
For Alex?
Because at first, as I said, there are certain things I but then after reading the book, I mean, how I enjoy your Robinson. When I realized that life can be the same even though you're from different
backgrounds. There are certain things you wouldn't do.
There are certain things that I said I wouldn't do.
Like what?
Like if certain people asked me to open the door, I would not. Because in one case, a guy asked me to open the door, he was Jewish, and I said, no, it's my religion also. So if I can, if it's internet, I would do it. But after reading, I realized that because of their religion, their background, they're not allowed to do certain things. And that's how they put me at a close to them. I love it.
And then what is
your life? Really,
it's
really changed my life.
Changed your life?
Yeah.
No, no.
How much does it say? Same thing. The thing that I would do for people. You know?
Like the beautiful lady.
Black person, as I said,
Exactly. There's a more.
Well, this is the first time, maybe the other time.